Make it so. Make it so. Make it so. Make it so.
And now, Making It So with Mike Mann and Josh Bald.
Hello and welcome to Making It So. My name is Mike Mann. With me as always, Josh Bald.
Hey everybody, Josh Bald here. Excited today, because we just talked to Rick Sternbach.
Yeah, we did.
My goodness, he is the man behind so many ship designs and props that have littered the Trekverse throughout the last decades. And he is, I say littered, it's not like he drew garbage, but he drew some of the most iconic props and ships that you can imagine.
Props, ships, what have yous.
His brain to paper.
Most beautiful things in the galaxies.
Right, to a design shop that became, so his brain children are things that you can pick out of a lineup, pick in silhouette. You can say, oh, that's the Voyager. I know that one.
Yeah. Maybe you've seen that before.
Oh, man. So it was really great to pick his brain.
Comm badge.
Yeah,
maybe.
The comm badge. The pad. Are you kidding me?
That? Yeah.
Hypospray. Picard's got a pile of pads. You know where it came from.
Exactly. Well, we had a wonderful conversation with Rick, and instead of us boring you, we should probably just get to it.
Yeah. Should we? We need to thank our friend Brian Strometz for our theme music, our opening and closing tunes there.
Oh, yeah, we haven't done this yet.
No.
Brian Strometz.
Sorry, Brian. So Brian Strometz was kind enough. We talked to him on our other podcast, and he was kind enough to make music for us that leads you in and leads you out. And it's a fun listen. So Brian is on Instagram at bstrometz. That's at bstrometz. You can also find him at brianstrometz.com. The Strometz is spelled the same on the website. I won't bore you with it again.
That's right.
But he's a talented musician. Say that again. He is a talented musician. He's a funny guy. He's worth a follow on Instagram. I'm seeing photos of sheet music, instruments. I believe there are some videos there. So I'm really excited to see what's going on with him. Thanks, Brian.
Yes, thank you very much for our sweet music. And with that, a little conversation with Rick Sternbach.
Pressing the button. You have to make your sound like.
Well, hello and welcome to Making It So, a conversation about Star Trek with those who helped create it. Decades ago, our guests put pen to page and designed the future that still feels futuristic today. As a senior illustrator with Star Trek, he drew into existence the pad, the communicator badge, the next-gen phaser, and the Starship Voyager, among countless other things that you see on screen day in and day out if you watch Star Trek day in and day out like we know you do.
And we
he is the man who drew tomorrow, joining us today, Rick Sternbach. Hello, sir. How are you?
Hey, real good. Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you for joining us. So much to cover, so much to go through. I guess my first question to you is just, how did you fall in love with drawing?
Well, you know, it goes back to when I was like 2.5 years old. My dad was an architect. You know, I grew up with pencils and crayons and lots of paper, and you know, that's pretty much how that got started. And the other side of things was growing up in front of the television set. Okay. Vague recollection of things like Captain Video. Okay.
Oh. I'm not familiar with that.
No, look it up. You know, so I grew up in front of the TV in the 50s. Okay. You know, was able to watch science fiction movies TV shows. The future of us in space, all right, hadn't even happened yet. You know, But I, you know, here I was watching, TV shows like Men into Space, and catching up with movies like Destination Moon, Forbidden Planet, and all that kind of good stuff.
Yeah.
I just love to tell people that I grew up at a time when there was nothing man-made in Earth orbit.
Yeah.
Okay, we hadn't sent anything up yet. Okay.
Right. Yeah.
But science fiction stories had preceded the real thing, and preceded me. All of the stories of super science happening in the 20s, the 30s, and the 40s. When I got to watch all of these developments on television, okay, my brain just lit up.
Great.
So with the pencils and the pens and the crayons and the construction paper and all of that, I started drawing all this stuff.
Wow, so it started back then with the science fiction and the spaceships that early.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you were drawing at a time when that space travel, of course, was wildly speculative, and it still is to a degree, but you got to see, when I think of those movies, some of those that you mentioned, especially Forbidden Planet, when I think of those, I just think of how off the wall they seem now, but at the time, as a kid, that must have really gripped you.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. For me, a lot of the films that I gravitated toward had some kind of engineering reality behind them. If you look at Destination Moon, okay, there was a lot of hard science and real smart aerospace technology that went into that. Okay.
Oh, neat.
And plus the fact that you had people like Chesley Bonestell, who was like, we worship as the granddaddy of astronomical artists. Bonestell was in on films like Destination Moon and Conquest of Space and things like that. And for me to see these films, and also in elementary school, being able to look at all of the books that were out there on space travel, again, before we even did it.
Right, right.
And just looking at these paintings, wonderful paintings and drawings, and then, watching on the TV news, things like Sputnik and Explorer and the Mercury program and all of that. It was just a great time to grow up.
Wow.
So you were able to follow that. It sounds like you followed it for a long time into your adulthood.
Yeah, never let go of it.
Wow.
in school, okay, when transistor radios became available and small enough to hide in your pocket.
Uh-huh.
Okay, I used to hide in the coat closet in school and listen to some of these missions on the news.
Oh wow, that's
okay.
Great.
Yeah, yeah. So yes, I was supposed to be doing something in homeroom, but nah, I was in the closet listening to Gemini 4.
Wow.
So this stuff really did.
It engaged your mind.
Well, yeah, and everything that I did in this area, okay, it was like, spirals of DNA, okay.
Yeah.
As soon as I graduated high school, okay, I was in the class of 1969, and I told my folks, I have to go to the Cape to see Apollo 11 take off.
Wow.
I'm sorry, I have to go.
Yeah. Was that a long trip from where you were?
No, I was living in Connecticut, so it was it was not that bad a flight. I had saved up some money from summer jobs and that kind of thing. I only got within like 9 miles of the launch pad. But I was there with a bazillion other people and got to see them take off.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
I guess I don't know how powerful those things are. Did you get to feel it from 9 miles away? Or?
Not really.
Okay.
Not really. Yeah, maybe you could hear a distant rumble. Uh-huh. Now, fast forward to April of 1970. I got a press pass to go see Apollo 13.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
I was 3.5 miles away with all the reporters and the camera guys and all this. Holy cow.
Yikes.
Yeah.
Now, did you acquire this press pass legitimately?
Yeah, you know, like, if you watch the movie Apollo 13, There's a scene where the NASA guy tells Marilyn Lovell, nobody watches this stuff anymore.
Right, yeah.
And just luckily, I happened to apply to NASA for a press pass with the backing of my local newspaper.
Oh, great.
Back in Connecticut. So I wrote an article on, you know, my experiences as, you know, a young person who was able to see this thing in person.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's so cool. Well, I can just imagine then the personal connection that you had when the whole ordeal happened to Apollo 13.
Well, what? Okay, here's the quick timeline. Okay, I flew down on a Thursday, took the bus tour with the rest of the reporters on Friday, went back for the launch on Saturday, went home on Sunday. Monday night, the thing blew up.
Okay.
And the oxygen tank exploded.
Uh-huh.
I did not get a good night's sleep until the Friday that they landed back home.
Yeah.
That's how crazy I was about this. Okay. Yeah. You know, I have to sit in front of the TV 24/7.
Right. Because this played out on the television for, you know, through the news programs, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay. So, you know, for about 4.5 to 5 days, this thing was a huge story, and we had no idea if they were going to get back okay.
Right.
And now, was your article written by then, or had your article incorporated this whole ongoing thing?
Boy, you know, that's a long time ago. I don't remember. I will have to go digging through the archives here.
Well, you don't have to do that on our behalf.
But I mean, there are those of us who followed the space program from a very early age, drew pictures of it, you know, watched everything we could on television. You know, I get a little jangled about this whole thing because it was such an amazing time.
Yeah.
You know, to be able to go see these things, you know, and see them with their own eyes. Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And it makes me wonder, did you ever consider doing the real thing yourself? Because you obviously have drawn, and I say drawn, it seems like such a pedestrian word for what you do. I guess illustrate, designed so many, you know, spaceships throughout your career. Did you ever consider working on the real thing?
I had thought late in high school of, you know, pursuing engineering, but the art really took over. So I became an art major in college. And then after 2 years of that, I had this crazy notion, oh, I think I'm going to switch my major to biology.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because I was crazy about biology in general, about marine mammals in particular. But a year into being a bio major, I was actually starting to get good enough to sell to the book and magazine market.
Oh, okay. So you had a practical impetus for shifting your focus away from biology at some point.
Yeah, well, I started in art. Briefly toyed with the idea of going into bio, but then went back to art. And when I found I could sell my stuff, I said, oh, hey, you know, I'll do this.
What are you illustrating at this point in time in those college years? Is it strictly space related, or is it is there more things that you're illustrating at that point?
Well, you know, as an art major in school, I was doing things like life drawing and art history, color theory. You know, so I was doing lots of different things with a lot of different media. What I was doing on my own time, were techie sorts of things, science fiction-y sorts of things. And when I left school, I really started to push into space art, you know, astronomical things, space hardware. And when I found that the book and magazine art directors liked my work, I stuck with it.
So you were doing that for a while, and then at some point, I read your Wikipedia page, so, you know, but it's fun to talk to people with a wiki page, by the way.
Okay.
At some point, though, there was a move, a career move, and a physical geographical move to pursue that more fully. Is that right?
Well, I stuck around Connecticut until 1977, okay?
Okay.
But now, prior to that, okay, prior to heading out to Los Angeles, okay, 1974, I was still living in Connecticut, just a little outside of New Haven, and I look in the local paper, and there's a little article: Gene Roddenberry is coming to Yale University
to do
a screening of The Cage.
Oh.
And I saw this, and I said, huh. Well, I cold called Paramount Pictures.
Oh my gosh!
Wow!
I cold called. I got in touch with somebody. It might have been Gene's assistant. And I introduced myself. I said, you know, hi, I'm Rick Sternbach. I'm a illustrator doing space and science fiction. I understand Gene's coming to New Haven to show The Cage. Would it be possible to maybe meet with him for a couple of minutes after the screening? And they said yes.
That's
wow.
That seems impossible.
Well, the amazing thing was, okay, now 1974, this was just 2 years after the last moon landing. And the Apollo-Soyuz mission hadn't even happened yet. I think we were still in the midst of Skylab. And I got to meet up with Gene after the show, and we ended up talking for maybe 2 hours.
Wow.
That's outstanding.
You know, learning about, like, his vision for the future. Okay, what should we be doing in space? Ideas that he was having about either a feature film or another television series. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now, this wouldn't happen for another few years.
Right.
Okay. Well, by the time Star Trek the Motion Picture, not even that, but the Phase 2.
Right.
Okay. Right, the development of Phase 2.
Okay. When Phase 2 was happening was about the time that I did an exploratory mission to Los Angeles. Okay. And I met up with the art department crew doing Phase 2. Met up with Joe Jennings, John Cartwright, set designer, Mike Miner, senior illustrator on the project. And Joe Jennings, the production designer, the top art director guy, I left my samples with him, and Joe said, look, I got to be honest with you, I don't have anything for you. Okay. And this was late 1977. They were starting to do things with Phase 2. So I checked out a few other studios, you know, met up with a few people at MGM. The facility that was ILM in Van Nuys before they headed up north to Marin County and saw what they were doing with Battlestar Galactica, which was very cool. They had finished up Star Wars and they were working on Galactica. And I did happen to nail a very short job over at Disney on the Black Hole.
Oh, cool.
So that ran for a couple of months, okay? Well, when they decided at Disney to, like, stop pre-production and work on the script some more, okay, I was out of work.
Oh, gosh.
And I was all set to, like, hoof it back to Connecticut.
Yeah.
You know, and not do this anymore. Well, funny thing, I was able to get a couple of other little, you know, jobs to allow me to stay in L.A. And one evening, I get a call from Joe Jennings from Phase 2.
Uh-huh.
And he said, they're announcing the feature film in the morning. Do you want to come in?
Wow. So he held on to your contact information all that time and thought of you. Wow.
Heck yeah. Yeah. So they announced the Star Trek the Motion Picture at a press conference on stage.
Uh-huh.
And the next morning came in and got hired.
Wow.
That's so great.
Wow.
And that was the start of what I term my newbie era. Okay. Yeah, I had a little experience over at Disney, and yeah, I had worked for some art directors, back in the New York market.
Yeah.
But I did not understand feature film production until I experienced what it was like on the Paramount lot for TMP.
Wow. So you're learning on the job.
Oh yeah.
On the motion picture. That's incredible. It also
I was learning from some of the most amazing people on that production. My immediate superior, if you will, was Mike Miner. And Mike was a fantastic illustrator. We lost him way too early. John Cartwright was the lead set designer. I learned a lot from him. Mm-hmm. And John Cartwright, father of Veronica and Angela.
Oh,
I know their names.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And Joe Jennings. Okay. Joe, you know, a lot of these guys were old school. Okay. And Joe, as a production designer, I've learned a ton from him. He actually took off to do a little program called Shogun. Okay.
Yeah.
And Harold Michelson came in to replace Joe as production designer. And Harold was just an astounding teacher. He had worked with Hitchcock. He had been on a lot of, feature films. And he taught me how to take, blueprint drawings, okay, and project up into a perspective scene that was so precise that if a director said, hey, I want a window 6 feet up on this particular wall, you could track that back to the blueprints and the set designers would be able to insert that window.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And this was all before CGI. This was all before, we had any kind of computer hardware in the office. This was all blueprints and, 4-H pencils and triangles and T-squares.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Oh, my gosh. So that level of specificity, do you think that what these guys were modeling for you and just how precise they were, how did that inform you going forward as you're working on the motion picture and subsequent projects?
Well, the motion picture, my work ended up being mostly in doing things like console graphics and signage for around the sets.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so, I ended up doing a lot of control panel stuff, and we were given a particular set of rules for how the console graphics had to be laid out so that the guys who were actually building the light boxes that went underneath the graphics, they had very specific dimensional rules that we had to follow for the light bulbs and the wiring and all of this sort of thing. So if you look at some of the graphics from the motion picture, you will see in some cases a very regular pattern of lit up areas. Okay, and that was all because of the physical stuff involved underneath the console itself. So I learned a bunch of that stuff. We worked with the sign shop on creating graphics for the walls and things like that. And I also got into, you know, little bits of sketching of some of the sets and giving Harold Michelson, you know, a couple of little suggestions here and there. Again, I was the new guy, okay? I was this newbie illustrator. But, I passed along whatever little ideas I thought I could contribute. And also working with Mike Miner was so cool because Mike understood science fiction, okay? And he understood film production. And one day, I brought in a pile of Aviation Week magazine issues, and we're flipping through there, looking for shapes, looking for ideas. And Mike sees this turbofan jet engine, and the blades of the turbofan, and that's what's up in the ceiling on the bridge. Okay.
Yeah. So you're transferring these ideas as you accumulate them and getting those into the design.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we had all kinds of reference books and magazines, and if there was some high tech thing that we could adapt, you know, we did it. All right, and we were looking for ideas for some of the furniture on the rec room, and you notice they're fairly simple shapes, okay, like large sort of rectangular seats in orange and dark brown, and they were essentially blocks of foam that were covered with Naga hide.
Oh, okay.
All right. Yeah. All right. Okay. Yes, they were very futuristic looking. Okay, but they were sort of plain, and Harold was leafing through an issue of Domus magazine. Okay, and it's a magazine about interior design, and he's looking and he says, "Oh, look at this! The Italians, they've done it all." You know. And we wish that we could have taken some of these, commercial products, chairs and desks and all of this sort of thing. But we really were kind of limited as to what we could purchase or build. All right.
Yeah.
But looking through these magazines, it's like, oh man, I wish we could have done this. You know, we could have bought this piece here or that piece there, but we did get some ideas. You know, from looking through all of these reference materials.
What ratio do you think was, as far as spending your time, what do you think the ratio was of research to idea creation and execution? In general, doesn't just have to be for TNP.
I'm not sure you could put an actual number to it. You know, we got ideas from everywhere, regardless of the project or what era we were talking about. Okay, TMP was one era, TNG, DS9, Voyager, another long connected period. But I personally was pulling stuff together from, you know, every place I could think of. Okay, if something struck me visually, if I saw something in a book or a magazine or whatever, I thought, maybe we could use this. Okay, one of the stories I've told a number of times is when we were starting to do a lot of the small hand props for next gen, the Hypospray came up.
Uh-huh.
And I did a number of doodles of hardware that could be two-handed, like McCoy.
Right.
You know, when McCoy was using his Hypo, it was a two-handed affair. All right. Roddenberry wanted a lot of this hardware to be, you know, sleeker, easier to use. And I just happened to have been on an asthma medicine.
Oh.
For about a year, you know, came and went.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm looking at my inhaler.
Yeah.
I'm looking at my inhaler, and it's like, oh my God, it's got a replaceable ampule. It's got a nozzle. Oh my gosh, maybe I could do something with that.
Right.
And that's how the Hypo came about for Dr. Crusher.
That's so great.
That's fascinating.
Okay.
Just what's in your hand.
No. Yes. Right. Okay, so this piece of plastic with this little vial of medicine, this pressurized canister, okay, you know, I looked at it and I said, oh, I can use this.
Yeah.
I can use this. You know.
This has legs.
Yeah, but you know, and then you get into the technical details of something like that. Okay, so you build up an entire description of how this thing works, and that gets passed along to the actors. Same thing with the tricorder. Same thing with the communicator badge. Things like that. We you know, on the motion picture, we got to reinvent a number of things. For me, it was mostly around the set, okay? But for starting with Next Generation, it was another reinvention of the things that we understood, okay? And how do you evolve those things over time?
I'm really interested in that process and how that worked for you getting into TNG and then having that opportunity to reinvent some of these ideas that had been around for the original series. What was that like? Who did you have to talk to and work with to put all that together?
Well, by the time TNG started up, you know, Herman Zimmerman was our first season production designer. We all got to know what each of us in the art department understood about Trek, things like set design and doing sketches of things. Michael Kuda and I really started to jam on the high-tech stuff. Andy Probert was in there designing the Enterprise D and some alien things, and we all started gyrating and working on these different things, and periodically sending sketches over to the producers, sitting in production meetings and finding out exactly what it was they were looking for, you know, making revisions, and just, you know, the whole process was actually pretty smoothly running, okay? Now, Next Gen, there were stories about the first couple of seasons, having some difficulties. I don't think that what we were doing in the art department, had any real speed bumps at all. You know, occasionally the producers would say, okay, look, you know, this is not the thing we're looking for, you know, come back with a couple of more sketches. Okay, and that's normal.
Yeah.
That's normal. I would say out of the, 14 or 15 years that I spent with the franchise, I would say about 75 to 80% of my stuff sailed through.
Wow.
Without a lot of revision, okay? You know, occasionally things would develop, and at a certain point, like with Voyager, okay, I had one ship I had one version of Voyager that we thought was going to be this ship.
Yeah.
Okay. As you may be aware, Eagle Moss has turned out a diecast of the prototype.
I've seen this. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. And
fascinating. Yeah.
I thought that ship was going to be the ship. So we built a mock-up, and the producers looked at the mock-up and they talked amongst themselves. And Jerry Taylor, Jerry was terrific. I would do anything for her. Jerry pulls me aside and says, could you make it a little curvier, kind of like a Lexus? And I looked and I said, okay, all right, for you, Jerry, I'll do it. Yeah.
Yeah.
and that's how we got the curvier, the smoother looking right. Voyager. It wasn't a difficult revision because a lot of the basic elements, okay, and this doesn't just apply to Voyager, but a lot of the other sets and props and things that might have looked okay, but they wanted just a few more things to change. And if we had the time, and if we had the budget, we revised things and refined them. The difference between the prototype Voyager and the final Voyager is really mostly the exterior lines. Okay, all of the details were still usable. So the bridge was the bridge. The phaser strips were the phaser strips. The transport emitters were the same. Uh-huh. So all of the little elements that got applied to the hull, okay, were the same. It's just that the shape of the hull changed.
Yeah, I'm looking at them. I'm looking at them side by side right now, and
they're much more triangular.
It's more rounded in the final design than the concept one is.
Yeah, and
yeah. They both look great, by the way.
Yeah, thanks. I think they wanted to see more of a lineage with the Galaxy Class Enterprise. Okay, which had a lot of compound curves, uh-huh. And that's fine. I'm okay with that.
Right.
Yeah. This is the sort of thing that happened all the time. One other quick thing that I can tell you, there was an episode of Deep Space Nine where the script had described the most fabulous object in the galaxy.
No pressure.
Yeah.
Okay, I don't know what this is. All right.
Sure.
And it was some sort of wonderful art object. I got into drawing some. I think John Eaves got into drawing some of it. Either John or Jim Martin. And we all submitted sketches of this thing. Okay, my thoughts were sort of heading toward a Fabergé egg. Beautiful, ornate, sculpted elements, but alien at the same time. Okay, I don't think they went with any of my sketches, but this was, we submitted drawings, and they said, "Nah, do a couple more," and we did some more. And they finally picked one, and I think it was one of John's. But, that was the rare occasion where we just drew and drew and drew, and finally, it's almost too late to get this built.
Yeah.
still not the most beautiful object in the galaxy yet. Sorry, guys. One more pass at it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
As an aside to that, I was curious about, and I think you described that situation, and I think that's probably what I was going to ask about, is that idea of, did you ever feel like you had the design, and it was good, and it was given back to you and said, we need this to be different, or did you disassociate yourself from those designs, and just, you were okay with revising if somebody wanted it revised?
Oh, we are there in aid of the production. Okay.
Right.
Yes, with things like Voyager, I thought the prototype would have been a perfectly valid ship. Okay, but it's not my sandbox.
Uh-huh.
So, yes, of course, we go back and we adjust things or come up with more, more concepts. And, like I said, most of the time, my initial sketches, they got an approval check mark. The stuff had to get off to the prop makers or the sign shop or, go to the set designers to get built for real. And I never, I never thought of any of these designs or concepts as my firstborn child.
Right.
Okay. But, anytime that something went through approvals and got turned into something physical that you could actually hold, it's like, oh, this is so cool.
Yeah.
The first time that AMT produced a kit, a plastic kit based on one of my ships, I think it was the Klingon attack cruiser.
Don't
and need. they sent me a test shot. They sent me a test molding of the kit.
Right.
And it's like, oh, this is so neat.
Yeah.
I've never had a model made from one of my things.
That is so cool.
And I just have to giggle about it because, it eventually ends up on the toy store shelf somewhere.
Yeah.
Oh my God, this is so cool.
Exactly, and thousands of people are putting it together.
Well, and the stuff that Playmates made, the hand props that Playmates was able to turn out, and also some of the ship things that they did. I got the Playmates Voyager sitting on top of my TV.
That's neat.
Cool. Oh, that is cool.
On a related note, I'm curious as far as you were charged with designing Voyager, and I assume you had more than a few days like you would when you're working on a specific episode. So what would be, how does your approach to making or designing Voyager differ for when you're week to week designing something else for one episode?
Well, a hero ship like Voyager, okay, I think start to finish was about 5 months.
Oh, cool.
All right. Now, Voyager, the producers had started getting into Voyager while we were still doing Next Gen.
Oh, really?
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Well, yeah, because they got their story ideas together. And so we were still working on the last few episodes of TNG. And I started sketching, things for Voyager. So it was like working on two shows at once.
Yeah.
In between seasons, we have, a production hiatus where, we kind of go away for a couple of months.
Yeah.
A lot of us didn't go away for a couple of months. we were working straight through the hiatus time and getting things approved, getting things altered. Voyager went through the changes that it went through. And when they finally, approved the blueprints that I turned out for the curvy version of the ship,
yeah.
That's when I had to start in on just piles and piles of sketches of the details. Okay. What does the antimatter loading hatch look like? What does the bridge look like? What is, what are the details for the phaser strips and that sort of thing?
Yeah.
All of that stuff, including the blueprints, had to go to Tony Meininger's model shop, Brazil Fabrication. So we stuck with Tony, handing off more and more details, I got to visit the shop every so often to see the progress on the 5-foot model.
Neat.
Oh my God! Yeah, these guys were amazing.
Oh, cool.
And you know, so that's one extreme. The five month design process. You know, other designs were, honest to God, they were like scribbles on the back of an envelope, which would then be faxed over to one of the CGI vendors, and they would turn that into like an alien ship of the week.
In comparison to your Voyager design is what you're saying, essentially.
Yeah, okay, I mean, yeah. You know, some designs really could be scribbled. They could be scribbled with a couple of handwritten notes and just, you know, sent off. Because we would some of these things, we would only see them for like 20 seconds.
Right.
In one episode and never see them again.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Other things like... the Vorcha, the attack cruiser, the Klingon ship. Yes, we had to spend a little bit more time working in Klingon style. Okay, could this believably be considered a Klingon ship? Romulan stuff, Cardassian stuff, all of these different styles really had to be... kept separate and put into props and put into ships so that you could watch an episode and know instantly, okay, oh, that's a Cardassian fighter or something.
Was there a sort of cultural Bible for each group?
Bible? I think mentally in our heads we kept that.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. We had the miniatures to look at. We had the sets to look at. You know, some of the set photos ended up in a big binder. Okay. But I never really had to like consult that. The stuff that I was doing was stylistically in my cerebral cortex.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Right? So you're able to draw upon that while designing.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. And I could say the same thing about the other designers on the show, okay? Guys like Ricardo Delgado and John Eaves and Jim Martin, Doug Drexler, Mike Okuda. We all understood the stylistic cues that we had to hit, Herman Zimmerman, who was our, you know, he was originally on TNG and then took over on DS9, Star Trek Enterprise. You know, Herman said something very, very smart at the beginning of DS9. He said, "We have to think like Cardassians." Okay, yeah. which is how we got the interior look of the promenade, of the station. We had to get certain lines and colors and shapes, you know, burned into our brain.
Yeah.
Right.
I can tell you as a fan, when I watched that, and that's my favorite series, you know, going forward, but watching that as a kid transitioning from TNG, it was quite jarring, but effectively so, because it was so different as far as what it looked like and the vibe that it put off.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, I think that it was a really good choice, especially because you had the two series, that and Voyager, going concurrently to differentiate them stylistically, visually, so that they look different.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, you don't want to confuse your viewers, I guess.
Right.
Yeah. A lot of the major civilizations, you know, had their own particular style. Aliens of the week sort of thing. You know, we could pick and choose bits and pieces of set, paint them a different color, you know, add different light fixtures and that sort of thing. And yes, you would end up with something different, but you know, using bits and pieces that we've used before. That happens on any, you know, really on just about any kind of production, where you will see, you know, wall panels of a certain kind, or beams going across the ceiling and down to the floor. You know, television, at least during the time that I was at Paramount, okay, we did not have an infinite budget.
Right.
And I don't think, you know, most science fiction, you know, most pop media SF today, you know, can afford every single thing. Okay. Some stuff you can do green screen, some stuff you can do CGI and get a really good look. You know, so I mean, you know, it all depends on the production.
So when you were designing, are you thinking I'm having to design within budget, and you know, I'm thinking of the resources that we've used before and what can I repurpose? And oh, okay, this pylon is going to look kind of like something that I can use for this, or are you thinking I'm on an unlimited budget and then they're going to have to deal with that in the manufacturing process and later on?
Well, a lot of the set stuff, I wasn't involved in. Okay, I might have to create a sketch of a set, but the basic ideas for the sets were coming from the set designers and the production designer. So I was never really in there saying, "Hey, I think the set should look like this." That wasn't my job
at
all.
Sure,
and that wasn't mine at all. But what I was very happy about was the fact that again, since we were on such a time crunch normally, okay, every 10 working days we were into a new episode, okay.
Yeah.
For me to sketch, you know, 4 or 5 different drawings of a particular set in time for a production meeting. You know, I told Richard James, who was our production designer on most of TNG and Voyager, can we just build models? And that worked out so much better for us. We could take foam core and, you know, take what the set designers were drawing, okay, spray mount that to foam core, cut it out, assemble it, hot glue it all together, and have a physical model of the set to bring to a meeting. And the directors loved it.
Oh, it's so concrete, you know? For them. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, yeah, because you could have a director. I remember there was one set that we built. Rick Colby was the director on a certain episode, and he's looking around the set. And he's looking from side to side on the model and trying to figure out, okay, which wall can I wild out? Okay, where can I put the cameras? You know, what sort of real interesting effects lighting could we have in here? And it was very interesting to watch the directors and the producers hover around these models.
Yeah.
Okay, and some of these things were maybe, you know, 2 foot by 2 foot.
Uh-huh.
You know, like 2-story sets with staircases and arches and, you know, windows and all sorts of things like that. So we were able to help that process along with actual physical representations. And that really kind of freed me up to come up with sketches for props that we needed, ships, large set pieces like like alien consoles or a big standalone computer module or things like that. having to take the time to do pretty renderings, okay, was not something I was comfortable with.
Yeah.
I mean, I could have done it, but but the model work, physical set representations were very, very useful. I was very happy about that.
Now, when you got to watch these directors and producers pore over these models, do you think you started to take on their perspective when designing them going forward? In the sense that, you know, oh, I'm going to put a window here or make a space where they can put a camera, that sort of thing.
Yeah, well, I wasn't the guy designing the set in the first place.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm the guy who made, sketches of things based on what the set designers were working up.
Okay.
But, at the same time, if I was drawing something for a particular episode, and let's say it was a certain alien object or something as mundane as a cargo container, okay, I had to know what style I was working with, all right?
Yeah.
After a couple of seasons of working with these people on the lot, okay, a lot of it became just, second nature. We just did it, okay, and they trusted us, and we got, hundreds of episodes in the can.
Right. that unspoken language that you have with one another is apparent through all this footage that we've seen. With all these great sets and props and ships, it's truly remarkable. And because we've talked to a few people now, but it's still remarkable to me that this would all come together in 8 days. It just blows the mind.
Yeah, well, sometimes we work weekends too. So.
Oh, I'm sure. It sounds like you spent a lot of late nights, especially when you were in season.
A couple of late nights, yeah. But when I mentioned that every 10th working day we're into a new show. Okay.
Yeah. Right.
This means that we're doing post-production on one, we're shooting one, we're prepping a third, okay? We're actually, at times we're working on three episodes at once.
Yeah.
And to do that for 14 or 15 years, it was kind of hectic sometimes, but I wouldn't have passed that up for anything.
I can relate in the sense that I'm a middle school math teacher, and I teach 6th grade math, 7th grade math, 8th grade math every day, and I have to keep those straight in my head because there's different plans for each.
There you go.
Different groups and different whatever.
Yep.
So
yep.
Totally. It is tough some days.
So, yeah. Rick, I'm curious, after all that and after all those years, I'm curious what your relationship with Star Trek is now and how you're able to enjoy it, if you do still enjoy it, and if you're able to watch it and what that experience is like for you.
Oh, it's still fun. It's still fun. Although I will be very honest and tell you that I have seen one episode of Discovery.
Uh-huh.
Okay. I have no fear of missing out. I will wait. I will wait until I can watch it all. I can still watch episodes from the original series, from all of the other shows up through, Star Trek Enterprise. Get a little something out of each one. It's still fun. The movies are still fun. I can't really say that, this is all behind me and there's other cool things out there. Well, yeah, there are cool things out there, but, I think Star Trek has such a history. Those of us who worked on the different shows and the films, you know, we have just an amazing, just an amazing history to be proud of.
Agreed.
Oh God, absolutely.
Yeah.
How does that feel? Because you get to, when you watch it, to enjoy it, depending on the series, you're looking at stuff you've made or designed. So how does it feel to have contributed to this phenomena?
Oh, it's a great feeling. It really is. Although, you know, there are days when I will try to watch an episode, let's say The Inner Light, Next Gen. Okay. Which is, you know, a wonderful episode.
Right.
And yeah, I can see things that I worked on, but I try to kind of push that off to one side and just enjoy the show.
Yeah.
You know, and the characters and, you know, remember lines of dialogue and just, you know, how people looked and how they were feeling, you know, in this story. And then, yeah, later I can go back and say, oh, yeah, I worked on this little piece here. I built this over here. But all of the stuff that we did collectively, okay, we did collectively.
Yeah.
You know, it was a big team thing, and we all did our part. And, God, we have all this stuff that we can watch and other people can watch and enjoy and take, you know, and get something out of it.
Yeah. It sounds, you've given a lot of credit to a lot of people and we know it's a huge undertaking to create that show, but it really sounds like that was something that was really rewarding for you in that you were able to work with this team and cohesively for a long time.
Oh yeah. Oh, definitely. Definitely. You know, great bunch of people. You know, some did not get the credit on the credit rolls at the end, but you know, the folks that we got to work with on the lot and the CGI vendors and the model makers and the prop folks, you know, they all contributed to this. You know, one whole bit of history.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for your contributions, because the world of Star Trek looks amazing.
And, it sure does.
And we rarely get a chance to thank someone directly for that.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Yeah, well, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot.
I don't see it on our list, but Mike likes to have a stupid question, but I might hijack it. Do you feel like, Rick, that Apple owes you any intellectual property fees for the iPad?
No.
Okay.
No. I tell people that, you know, if you look at things like the Starfleet pad, okay, yes, it looks like the iPod, so what? For me, it's simply, I think, an example of convergence where styles of certain objects got simpler and more similar, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
Okay. I will say one thing about, you know, you mentioned Apple, okay, and our props and things. I have to look at the stuff that we built and scratch my head and say, how can we do this again and not look like something that's already out there?
Ah, yeah.
Okay, that has me shaking a little bit, okay? You know, there's a certain level of simplicity to the objects, and you can't get any simpler. You know?
Right.
You know, I mean, there's still room to make interesting high technology, and yeah, there would be ways to make it all work on the screen. If somebody came to me and say, "Okay, how would you design all of these things post Voyager?" I would have to sit down and doodle for hours, you know, to try to come up with something that was unique and more advanced.
Yeah.
All right. That would be the toughie. That would be the toughie.
Well, someone's got that job now because I guess the new Picard series is going to be taking place, whatever, 20 years after Voyager ended.
I wish him luck. I really do. I wish him luck.
Hopefully if they give you a call, at least you're already thinking about it.
They don't know me from a rock on the ground, so you know. But I'm here, you know.
if they had any sense in them.
Yeah.
Well, we really appreciate your time, Rick. It's really great of you to talk to us. Really kind
it's
of you.
So fun,
you bet.
Great conversation, and I appreciate it so much.
Excellent. Had a great time.
Oh, man, that was so much fun. Thank you again, Rick, for joining us. I learned a lot. What about you?
Oh, today I learned that team efforts are the best efforts. But I also learned that Rick did all this by hand.
By himself.
essentially by himself.
Team efforts are the best efforts. Well, but Rick did it all by himself.
I got to say, Rick essentially designed Voyager on his own. It sounded like he had an immense checklist, but he essentially put that together on paper, and it was able to be realized as a model through his creative genius.
It blows me away. And the fact that he's able to just be such a humble guy, blows me away.
We're finding that these men and women are so affable and so happy to talk about Trek because it was such a great experience for him.
Well, I think people have been great because they're not afraid to get real with us, too. I think Melinda Snodgrass, you know, she was real about Trek not being the best writing experience.
Sure, absolutely.
Things, so.
Hey, I'm glad they can be their real, true selves when they're talking to us, two strangers.
So. And being his real, true self with us next week, Max Cervantes. He has a varied history with Star Trek. He's worked as an extra in TNG. He's worked in the props department.
Yes.
Building props. And he's also worked in fan films, doing some set decoration and art department stuff.
We're going to ask him about all three of those facets for sure.
Yeah.
Yes.
Interesting guy. It'll be really fun.
So stay tuned for that one. Thank you all for listening again. Mike, if these wonderful listeners of ours want to get in touch with two strangers, how can they do so?
Yes, if they would like to get in touch with us, they can do so at Making It So Pod on Twitter or at Making It So Pod on Instagram. They can also do it at...
How about via email, Mike?
I was so close. I was almost there. They can also do it via email, makingitsopod@gmail.com.
Correct.
And I think I got it right. Yes.
Yes.
Also, please go to iTunes and leave us a 5-star review. I feel like a whore asking for that, but at least I'll be a whore with a 5-star podcast.
Hey, leave an honest review. But put 5 stars on it, please.
That'll at least make me feel better.
This could be the worst podcast you've ever heard. But tell us after putting the 5 stars in, please.
Exactly.
Because we only read those.
Right. <So. laughs> And maybe we'll read your review out on the podcast. Who knows?
Especially if it's hurtful.
Wouldn't that be delightful?
Yeah, that'd be great. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much for listening to us and for listening to our guest, which is really, come on.
That's what you come for.
Who you came for. Stay safe out there.
It has been made so. Thanks for listening. Live long and prosper.
Make it so.